Back in the good books, social media giant Facebook re-friends Australia, lifting the ban on news.
The tech giant has announced it will put Australian news content back onto its platform.
Facebook has re-friended Australia.
Hello, I'm Paul Barry. Welcome to Media Watch. And after a week of war, the government and media are again friends with Facebook, which has put news back on its platform and agreed to cough up some cash. And first to take advantage of the money on offer was Seven West, with CEO Kerry Stokes saying...
These are groundbreaking opportunities for all of our network and not limited entirely to news.
We don't know how much Facebook is paying Seven West for its content because that is confidential, as our deals announced last week by Private Media, Schwartz Media and Solstice Media, which publish Crikey, The Saturday Paper and The New Daily. And it seems Facebook believes it can decide who it will and who it won't pay, with the company saying...
We have come to an agreement that will allow us to support the publishers we choose to, including small and local publishers.
Note the phrase, we choose to. Note also that the last-minute stitch-up between Josh Frydenberg and Mark Zuckerberg gives Facebook and Google a way of avoiding the media bargaining code altogether. As Frydenberg explained to Nine's Today programme...
Before I, as the Treasurer, designate one of the digital platforms to which the code will apply, I would give them 1 month's notice. And also, ahead of making any decision about designating a particular digital platform under the code, I would take into account the commercial deals that have been put in place.
To escape the code, Facebook and Google will just have to persuade the government they have signed enough commercial deals. They may not have to sign deals with everyone. So who and how many could miss out? As Lee O'Connor, editor of the Canamble Times, told RN Breakfast...
I do feel like it's a bit like the main meal and the scraps. You know, I don't know that there is any genuine intent to ensure that regional audiences and regional media are properly looked after.
The Canamble Times is one of 160 small newspapers represented by Country Press Australia. And how close are they to a deal with Facebook or Google? Answer, not close at all. Country Press President Bruce Ellen, who hopes to negotiate a deal for all those papers, told Media Watch...
We're concerned regional, local and small publishers may be dealt out, particularly given the last-minute amendments have emboldened Facebook to say they can now pick and choose who they deal with. The government and the ACCC say regionals must be included and will take a very dim view if they miss out. We need it to happen. The government and the ACCC are confident it will happen. But under the law, it doesn't have to happen. Ultimately, it's going to be at the Treasurer's discretion.
Also nervous about where all this is heading is Angela Priestley, who owns and edits the website Women's Agenda.
You know, small publishers, independent media, regional newspapers, everything going on all across Australia that is run by entrepreneurs, it's run by people in towns who take a chance and take a risk on trying to do journalism in their town and in their community. We need some certainty now. So I'd like to see something happen rather fast, but at the same time, I think we're all feeling a little bit nervous at the moment.
To get any money off big tech, sites need to qualify as a news business under the bargaining code. And to do that, they'll need to have an annual turnover of at least $150,000, prove they're contributing to public interest journalism, and be registered by ACMA as a media business. But some small independent players fear they'll end up with little or nothing, even if they do meet those criteria. Charles Parkinson, owner of Renew Economy, asked Google if his content could appear on Showcase, and he was told...
News Showcase is a product for public interest journalism, so there may not be a great fit.
Renew Economy, which has a turnover in excess of $150,000, covers energy policy and renewables, so it's hard to see how it could not fit the bill. And not surprisingly, Parkinson asks...
On what criteria are these decisions being made? Who defines the public interest? What happens to the smaller publishers who are not the chosen ones? Does Showcase and Facebook News now mean that those publications paid by Google and Facebook will get priority over others?
But the ACCC's Rod Sims is adamant that no one will miss out, telling Media Watch...
Why would they, Google and Facebook, seek to do commercial deals with only the 6 to 7 news organisations that employ most of the journalists working in Australia and not those who are much smaller, which will cost them much less?
To save money, perhaps, or because they don't want their content? In the end, it may be up to Josh Frydenberg to decide the little bloke's fate. Will he go to war for them if Facebook and Google go back to making nuclear threats? We're not sure he will. But beyond who gets paid and who doesn't, it's fair to ask if the money flowing back to the media will also flow back into journalism. As Labour's Ted Husic says...
The test has to be, will we see more journalists? Will we see more outlets? Will we see more diversity? Or will this simply be a transfer of wealth out of the tech companies to the shareholders of big media? Because if it only is that, then the entire process is an utter joke and has not met what everyone was told at the start this would be about, which was to inject more diversity in one of the most concentrated media markets on the planet.
We don't yet know the answer to that, but it is looking better than last week, when some media sites look set to lose up to half of their audience. But now to Canberra and the latest bombshell over allegations of rape.
I can reveal that the Prime Minister's office, the Greens Senator Sarah Hanson-Young and Labor's leader in the Senate, Penny Wong, were all yesterday sent a letter from anonymous friends of a complainant of a sexual crime who alleges that a sitting cabinet minister raped her decades ago.
Four Corners reporter Louise Milligan broke the story of the anonymous letter on Friday evening, apparently against the wishes of the woman's family. The Courier-Mail then gave the allegation front-page coverage on Saturday, and Samantha Maiden followed up with more details in news.com.au, revealing that
a 45-minute recording of the dead woman talking about the allegations also exists. News.com.au has obtained the audio, but has chosen not to publish it.
News.com.au and every other mainstream outlet also chose not to name the minister. As Peter Van Onselen told The Project,
this cabinet minister with this allegation against him, we know it's a he, he can't be named for obvious reasons it would be considered defamatory. But by the same token as that, if he's not named, then you've got a little over a dozen males in cabinet who are all besmirched by this. And there's always the risk that in the alternative media that they move in a way that the mainstream media doesn't and the person gets named somehow.
And indeed, that's already happening on social media and a couple of fringe news sites, with the minister's name trending on Twitter over the weekend and people offering circumstantial detail that they claim ties him to the alleged crime. So, how long before he's outed to the public or forced to stand down? Writing in The Conversation, longtime political reporter Michelle Grattan observed,
one would think it is probably only a matter of time before the name is canvassed in a parliament under privilege.
Grattan says that would push the matter towards an outcome, unless, of course, someone in the media breaks ranks and does it first. And you can guarantee that's a conversation just about all editors and their legal advisers are having right now. But, of course, this is not the only rape allegation to be rocking Parliament. Over the weekend, historical rape allegations were raised against an unnamed Labor MP. And the early part of last week was dominated by another, much more recent case, with the media asking one question that no one in Canberra was answering.
Will we ever find out who knew what and when in the Brittany Higgins case?
There are still questions lingering over who knew what, when and why.
Again, those questions continue to mount over the timeline as to who knew what, when about these rape allegations.
There's so many unanswered questions, PVO. When will some of these questions be answered?
2 weeks ago, former Liberal staffer Brittany Higgins went to the media to say she'd been raped in Parliament House in March 2019, with Samantha Maiden breaking the story on news.com.au and Lisa Wilkinson getting the young woman to tell her story on The Project that night.
I woke up mid-rape, essentially. He was sweaty. I couldn't get him off of me. At this point, I started crying.
What did you say to him?
I told him to stop.
Did he?
No.
Since then, reporters in Canberra have all been pressing government ministers for straight answers, but with little success. Defence Minister Linda Reynolds, who was Higgins' boss at the time of the alleged assault, refused to say whether she had disclosed the rape allegations to other ministers, or if the alleged rapist was denied a termination payout. And Prime Minister Scott Morrison claimed he didn't know anything until Higgins went public, even though staffers in his office had been alerted several times about the alleged crime. Then last week, Home Affairs Minister Peter Dutton found himself at the centre of the media storm as it emerged he knew about the alleged rape days before the story broke, but had not told the PM. And when journalists tried to question him on this, Dutton took cover, as journalist Samantha Maiden told ABC's The Party Room.
I just think that's a problematic culture. If you've got an office with Peter Dutton has three press secretaries and they are so contemptuous of the press that they refuse to return their phone calls.
And The Guardian's Catherine Murphy clearly had similar problems getting answers from Dutton's office, telling readers,
The Higgins story isn't trivial. It's about as serious as it gets. And citizens of this country, the voters who send Dutton to Parliament to represent their interests, have every right to expect prompt and honest answers to basic questions. But what they got was smug, disdainful silence from a senior cabinet minister who wields significant power.
But it's not just that journalists have found it hard to get answers. According to TENS, political editor Peter Van Unselen, the PM's office was allegedly also throwing doubt on Higgins' credibility and motives.
The Prime Minister's office has been backgrounding that her now partner has a vendetta or a gripe, might be the better way to put it, against the government because of him being a former public servant.
And Van Unselen told MediaWatch that his attempts to confirm that story have been stonewalled too.
The PMO simply won't answer my questions about the backgrounding against Brittany Higgins' partner. I suspect that's because they don't want to lie and deny it, so they just plead the fifth and stay silent.
So, after 2 weeks, we still don't know how many ministers knew about the allegations and why no one bothered to tell the Prime Minister about the incident. But, of course, this is not the first time a government, and indeed this government, has failed the transparency test. ABC 730's Paul Farrell claims he was stonewalled last month when he asked Peter Dutton about alleged pork barrelling via government grants. And when Carl Stefanovic raised it on Today, Dutton stonewalled yet again and responded with a personal attack.
Have you been pork barrelling in marginal seats?
No, Carl.
It looks that way.
Again, you've got to, you know, by his colleagues' interpretation, a C-grade journalist at the 7:30 report trying to do a hatchet job. Blah, blah,
with a Liberal Party logo.
And 2 days before that, ABC Breakfast host Michael Rowland had copped a similar spray when he tried to quiz Health Minister Greg Hunt about branding a government vaccine announcement with a Liberal Party logo.
I know this is an issue for you. In many ways, you identify with the left. You do this a lot, and I respect
no,
that.
No, Minister. No, no, no.
You're open about that.
I find that offensive. I'm asking you.
There's nobody who's watching who doesn't identify you with the left. You should be open about that. I'm open about my origins.
But when it comes to deflecting questions you don't want to answer, few do it better than the PM himself.
Prime Minister, just on sports grants.
Prime Minister, Audit Office Prime officials Minister. Told Prime us Minister, in an inquiry on Wednesday that Bridget McKenzie's senior advisor...
Prime Minister, this was a year that...
Prime Minister, Audit Office officials
UK
told
at
us...
the moment about Tony...
Audit Office officials told the Senate inquiry...
When do we hope the Commonwealth...
When do you told the Senate inquiry on
Wednesday?
I think
we're going to stay with the health of Victorians today. Yep.
So, why does the government brush off these embarrassing questions? Because it can get away with it. And the PM has long shown his ministers how it's done. Remember this regular refrain in the run-up to the last election.
I don't get distracted by the Canberra bubble.
Okay.
You're asking me about the issues of commentators in the Canberra bubble, and that's part of the problem with Canberra bubble politics. I'm not in the Canberra bubble, I'm out of it.
And who could forget Morrison's performance on asylum seekers and boat arrivals back in 2014, when he steadfastly refused to answer questions about what he called on-water matters. This was one of the highlights we showed you on MediaWatch.
There is no such report for me to provide to you today. If there was a significant event happening, then I would be reporting on it.
So what does that mean? If the boat sinks, you'll tell us?
You're a bright journalist. I'm sure you can work it out.
No, we're asking you, sir. You're the minister.
And I've given you my response.
Well, I don't understand your response.
I'm on my way into the Federal Council, and I was happy to provide a doorstop because I understood journalists had questions today.
Could you clarify, sir, for us, at what point does an event become a significant event involving a boat on the water?
When you see me standing and reporting on it.
So you determine...
And you're standing here reporting
it? I'm not. I'm saying there is no such report for me to provide to you today. There is, therefore, no significant event for me to report at sea.
So, is this stonewalling from politicians new? Certainly not. ABC political editor Andrew Probyn told us...
Media management has become a professional dark art, focused on control of information, containment and protection.
And he added...
A shrinking press corps is too often up against ever-expanding bureaucracies that spend massive amounts of time and energy attempting to tell journalists as little as possible.
But Seven's political editor Mark Riley says this government is actually more open than most.
It is much better now than when I came to Canberra in 1993. I found most difficulty in getting timely and complete answers from Keating government ministers and those in the Howard government, particularly in its first term and then again in the years after Children Overboard and during the Iraq War.
And guess who gets Riley's gong for being best in class? His verdict is...
The Morrison PMO is one of the best I've dealt with for timely and comprehensive information.
Now, that is clearly not everyone's view, and it may surprise some people. But Riley's next observation certainly won't, because he says don't even bother seeking answers from government departments.
Getting anything at all from the bureaucracy is often close to impossible. They routinely request written questions via email. It regularly takes several days to get any answer. Even then, it is usually of little use. Often, there is simply no answer. It was not always thus.
And that is all from us tonight. There's more on our website, where you can stream or download the programme and read statements from Andrew Probyn, Mark Riley and Peter Van Onselen. And don't forget, Media Bites every Thursday, online, on iView, YouTube, Twitter and Facebook. But for now, until next week, goodbye.
If you or someone you know is affected by any of the issues raised in this program, please contact the following services. Lifeline 1311 14. 1800 RESPECT. 1800 737 732.